When shooting ICVFX on LED volumes, proper color management is required to maintain a consistent color pipeline from content authoring through to displaying content on an LED wall and viewing that content back through a camera without disrupting the art direction of the original look. In this quick start tutorial, I'll cover the considerations that should be made, beginning with stage hardware, such as LED panels and image processors, how to set up a signal chain from Unreal Engine 4 to the image processor, creating your first OCIO asset with the included OCIO.config file in Unreal Engine 4.27, choosing input and output transforms, and applying sets of these transforms to the end display config actor. The workflow I'll be sharing here as a best practice is the same one that we used at NANT Stage in Los Angeles for the Unreal Engine 4.27 in-camera VFX production test. Before starting with color, there are a few expectations of hardware for this particular setup. We expect to be able to send a 10-bit per channel signal from our GPU. We expect LED panels on a stage to be capable of exposing their achievable gamuts to an LED processor. And we need to know whether our processor is expecting the signal to be gamma encoded or PQ encoded. In Unreal Engine 4, we'll match this expectation with our OCIO output transforms. So first things first, you don't need to set your render nodes to use HDR mode in your operating system, and you don't need to set HDR mode in your graphics driver control panel. These modes are intended for consumer displays and video games where HDR metadata has already been embedded, but this is not how we will be working with our LED volume. We don't want the operating system or the graphics driver to control how our values are going to be interpreted. In Windows, you can find this by going to the desktop, right-clicking for display settings, and looking at Windows HD color. We need this set off for this workflow. Instead, we need to tell our graphics driver to display our output signal in 10 bits per component. This will give us enough bits to work with to send an encoded signal with a wide gamut to the LED processor. At 8 bits, we will inevitably introduce banding, so 10 bits is necessary. We must also be sending a full range signal. LED processor control software will be able to tell you whether you've successfully achieved this, usually in an info panel for the incoming display signal. The reason we can do this is because our Unreal Engine 4 frame buffer is being targeted at half float. We're always drawing HDR values when pixels are rendered. By setting our GPU to output 10 bits per channel and encoding our linear scene values, we're able to represent these values with a greater range. On the LED processor side of this setup, we want to be sure that we've told the processor to display for however we've encoded that signal, which could be with gamma or PQ encoding. Once you've set this to PQ encoding, for an example, this is the Brompton to Sierra remote software, I would set my HDR format here to PQ to tell the LED processor, I am sending you a PQ encoded signal, please display it like that. When you've done this, things will look a little bit strange on the wall. But this is because what you're sending from the Windows desktop is encoded in sRGB color space. Once we finish doing our color transforms from Unreal Engine using OCIO, we will be turning this signal into a PQ encoded signal, which will display correctly on the LED wall. This is where the OCIO config comes in. Before we continue, let's cover what a PQ signal is and why we use them. The virtual scene in Unreal contains linear brightness values. If one object is twice as bright as another, the pixel that represents the bright one is twice the value of the other. The goal is to have the linear virtual scene be represented on the LED wall with the same relationships. The LED wall is intended to produce light similar to the real world, particularly if real-world objects are also represented with virtual counterparts. Inside the engine, linear data is represented using floating point math. In order to send the pixel data to the LED processor, that linear data must be converted into a signal which has less bits, usually 10 per channel, and this step is called color encoding. The processor will undo this step to make the data linear again for display on the LEDs. LED processors support different encodings for input signals. The two most common are PQ, also called ST2084, and gamma. When gamma is used, there is a value associated with that encoding, such as 2.35, 2.4, or 2.2, or 1.8. These encodings are often referred to as the EOTF, the electro-optical transfer function of the signal, because they define the relationship between the encoded value and the light on the display. We recommend using a PQ signal if it is available. One particular advantage to using PQ is that the EOTF defines a specific brightness for a given encoded value. This differs from gamma, because the gamma specification is a relative amount of light, not an absolute amount. With PQ, the responsibility lies with the display, in this case, the LED processor and the panels, to produce a known light amount for a given signal value. With gamma, an additional control is required on the processor that scales the overall peak brightness of the display. To prepare content for a PQ signal, the scene must have a known brightness that matches a target brightness on the wall. By default, we define the value 1.0 to mean 100 nits on the wall. With PQ, values well over 1.0 are also encoded, which allows the scene to be fully HDR from very dark pixels to very bright pixels. If your particular scene seems too dim, you can bring up the overall exposure of the scene using the exposure compensation, which you can find here inside of the end display config actor, under color grading, entire cluster, and here is our exposure compensation control. You can also adjust the overall scene brightness using the post-process color correction controls. These you will find in a post-process volume inside of your level. All of these controls operate linearly, which is what we expect, because we want the virtual controls to behave like light in the real world. If you must use a gamma signal, you also will need to find a scene value that targets a particular wall brightness. In the gamma case, a scene value of 1.0 will target the peak wall brightness, and all values over 1.0 will be clipped. The overall exposure compensation can be used for this, but it should be noted that the exposure used for gamma will be different from the exposure that's used for PQ. Now, before we get to configuring our OCIO configuration asset, let's toggle a few settings so that we get an accurate result. Portions of the post-processing chain should be disabled or set to zero to ensure that none of the normal UE camera effects are applied to the virtual content. Inside of your post-process volume, look for bloom and make sure this is set to true and has a value of zero. Do the same for vignette intensity, the tone curve, expand gamut, and blue correction. Now we've covered some of the hardware and signal setup, we'll get into creating our OCIO configuration asset. You can use your own config.OCIO file in these next steps if you have one, but we also supply one with the OpenColorIO plugin content to get you going. In the content browser, go to the view options in the bottom right corner, and enable the show flags for show engine content and show plugin content. In the sources panel, look for OCIO, right-click the OCIO folder, and show an explorer. This is the one we supply. The OCIO file contains the color spaces that we will later define inside of the OpenColorIO configuration asset, and the LUTs folder contains LUTs that are referenced by the config.OCIO file. We need to include both of these together, with the LUTs folder coexisting with the OCIO file, into our project content directory, which for me is this folder here. Once that's done, go back to your content directory, go to the folder you've put these in, and we'll create an OpenColorIO configuration. So right-click the content browser, go to miscellaneous, and OpenColorIO configuration is what you want to make. Once this is created, double-click to open up the OpenColorIO configuration asset panel, browse for the configuration file, And now you're ready to add color spaces to your OpenColorIO asset. Now we're going to add an array element for each color space that we'd like to include in our OCIO config asset. Unreal Engine generates OCIO shaders that are permutations of each color space defined in the asset, so you'll need to explicitly add the ones you would like to use. In this case, for the example, I'll only be adding two, but you can add more if you have them. So we'll add an element, click this dropdown, and the first space I'm going to add is Utility Linear sRGB. We're going to transform out of this space because Unreal uses an implicitly sRGB color space, as long as the textures have been authored that way and our light is linear. We'll add another element, and we'll select an output space. In this case, I'm going to use Output LED Walls PQ. This is what's going to transform for our Utility Linear sRGB source space to our destination space, which we would like to be PQ encoded in the end. We'll click the Save button to save the asset, and now this asset is ready to apply to the end display config actor. With those color spaces defined in our asset, we can close this panel, and now we'll select the end display config actor from the level. Scroll down in the details panel until you're at the OCIO panel. Make sure enable viewport OCIO is set to true. We'll select the new asset we made in the previous step. And I'm just going to reset these options here. In our source color space, we'll select Utility Linear sRGB. And for our destination color space, we'll select Output LED Walls PQ. You'll need to do the same for each ICVFX camera component you have in your end display config actor as well. This first option will do the outer frustum views, which are all of these panels here. So we'll select camera A. We make sure this is enabled. We select our config asset. Reset these again. And then select our spaces. At this point, you'll now be ready to run end display to your LED volume with PQ encoded linear values. The next step would be to generate a color transform matrix to add to your own config file, but we won't be covering that in this video. If you are interested in doing this, please take a look at the ICVFX camera color calibration docs at docs.unrealengine.com, where this process is covered. Thank you for listening, and we look forward to seeing your creations.